Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for joining me in today's CSO forum. This is an unusual format for us, and these are extraordinary times, and I really appreciate you taking time out of your days to spend some time with all of us at Dana-Farber. So the CSO forums have been going on for a while, and it's an opportunity for us to have a conversation with some of our scientists to describe some of the exciting stuff that's going on at Dana-Farber. Today, we have a special pleasure in that one of my colleagues who was the recipient of the 2019 Nobel Prize this year, Bill Kaelin, will be our speaker. Some of you who have been to CSO forums in the past know that these have been run by the former Chief Scientific Officer, Barrett Rollins. Barrett, after 15 years of being the founding Chief Scientific Officer, has decided to retire from that position, although he continues to be on the faculty and be our Chief Academic Officer. But I am going to try to step in those large footprints and lead the CSO forum going forward. I thought I would take a couple minutes just to describe what's been going on at Dana-Farber with the onset of the pandemic. Next slide. So Dana-Farber's open. We are seeing patients both on-site and online. We continue to have both inpatients and outpatients, although we've taken a lot of steps to protect both our patients and the caregivers during this time of the pandemic. We have had an amazing response of moving many, many visits offline, and about 2,000 visits occur through Zoom and other video conferencing. Therapeutic clinical trials continue to be pursued and are open for patients who are eligible for them. But unfortunately, we've had to close almost all the other lab and clinical research, both for the safety of our patients and the staff, but also to preserve the amount of personal protective equipment that we have available. But as we say, we're not shutting down research at Dana-Farber, but we're working remotely. And I would say that near all of our research groups are continuing to be very active. In fact, I think some of them are being very productive in analyzing their data and interacting through video conference and writing up their work and writing grant applications, time that they have to do because they're not in the lab. In fact, one of the things that I think has been quite impactful is that two of our faculty members, Nellie Poliak and David Weinstock, started a seminar series that's at noon 4 days a week. This is open to the entire research community throughout the United States, and there have been thousands of people who have been tuning in to hear lectures from people at Dana-Farber, but also faculty from other cancer centers around the world. Although we've stopped the majority of our cancer research, we have a few groups at Dana-Farber who are working on coronavirus. These are investigators who had previously been working on viral diseases, and so we have people working on antibodies that can be used both for diagnosis and for therapies eventually. We have people working on trying to create vaccines, and people trying to work on novel ways to create antiviral agents. It's too early to know whether these will be ready or impactful in the short run, but certainly we're very excited about the ability of our faculty to participate in and contribute to the effort. One thing that I think is, you've certainly seen in the news, and fortunately, we continue to have a supply of PPE, although this is having enough masks and gowns and gloves continues to be a very challenging search for us daily. But we are committed to keeping the Institute open and doing that in a safe way. One thing that we have done very recently is that we've converted part of our animal facility into a decontamination unit that can decontaminate up to 1,000 gowns, masks, and other personal protective gear every day. And that's supposed to come online in the next few days, and that will certainly help us make sure that we have all the equipment we need to take care of patients. I think the other thing that we have all reflected on in this time of change is, how much we can do, even if we can't come into work every day. And I think those are things that will be important for us as we move forward. But it's also, I think, a stark reminder to all of us that there's a lot of biology that we don't understand, and that fundamental research focused on the basic understandings of biology, whether it be focused on cancer or any other disease, continues to be something that is a national imperative. So with that introduction, next slide, I'd like to introduce our speaker today. So Bill Kaelin is one of our own. He grew up in Connecticut. He went to Duke for his undergraduate degree in mathematics and chemistry. He stayed at Duke for his medical degree, and then did his residency in internal medicine at Johns Hopkins, where he also served as a chief resident. This is Bill, sometime around the time that he started at Dana-Farber as a medical oncology fellow. And I show this slide in part because he's flanked by two other faculty members. On the left is Jim DiCaprio, and on the right is Barrett Rollins, who is, as I mentioned, the former chief scientific officer. So Bill has been known to us on the faculty for since he was a fellow, and I would say that he is a scientist. He's someone who always asks penetrating questions. He's skeptical, but skeptical in the best possible way. He's never satisfied with superficial answers. And although sometimes if you're presenting to him, that can be a little unsettling, we all know that looking for the right answer rather than the easy answer is the best way forward. And Bill has been a towering example of how important it is to do that. But at the same time, he's always had time to help his colleagues think through scientific questions, think about what's the right way to do things. And he's mentored numerous fellows and other colleagues who've gone on to have their own successful careers. Now, truth be told, we've all known or suspected that Bill was being considered for the Nobel Prize. He won the Lasker Award a couple of years ago, and the Gairdner Award in Canada a few years before that. And those are usually signs that somebody has taken notice of one's work. But a little bit like a pitcher throwing a no-hitter, none of us really wanted to talk about it. And I can say that in the fall, when Bill was announced as the Nobel Prize winner in medicine, it was something that we were all tremendously excited about for him. But it's also something we all said, they finally got around to doing what's right. And here's Bill a few months ago receiving the Nobel Prize from the King of Sweden. And you can see the other thing about Bill is that he's retained his youthful persona and looks. So he not only is he a great scientist, but he somehow figured out the fountain of youth. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Bill. We've actually forced him into a format where we have a few questions, and then he's going to make some remarks to each of the questions. Thank you, Bill, for joining us.
Great. Thank you, Bill, for that very nice introduction, and thank everybody who's on this presentation, witnessing it in cyberspace, for spending some time with us, and for your support of the Dana-Farber. So I've been asked to explain the work that led to the Nobel Prize. I do have to start with a disclosure. So I have a financial interest in a company called Fibrogen. I also started a couple of biotech companies and work for Lilly. So we have to start with a little primer of molecular biology. So molecular biologists are preoccupied with three classes of molecules: DNA, RNA, and protein. And there's a sort of a flow of information here. You can think of the DNA being like a master blueprint that's kept safe in a vault all the time. But on occasion, you need the information in that blueprint. So what the cell does is it makes effectively a Xerox copy in the form of RNA. And then that copy contains the instructions that are sent to sort of the factory floor to do something. And usually that's to make a protein. So again, the flow of information is DNA does RNA, RNA does protein. And so by analogy, imagine you had a blueprint for the truck. Here's the Xerox copy of the truck that then gets sent to the factory to actually make the truck. Now, scientists have a lot of jargon, and I'm going to try to demystify some of the jargon. So you hear the term gene all the time. What is really a gene when a scientist says they're studying a gene? So a gene is a segment of DNA that serves as one of those blueprints for making a protein. It's made up of four building blocks or bases, and scientists refer to those four building blocks with the letters A, G, C, or T when they're describing DNA. Roughly speaking, you have about 20,000 genes. And for most genes, you have two copies, the copy you got from mom and the copy you got from dad. So some of you might be aware or have heard of so-called binary codes made up of zeros and ones. So the DNA code is another type of code, but here it's a quaternary code because the code is really the sequence or order of those four building blocks I referred to a moment ago. And it turns out for humans, you have a string of DNA that would end to end be approximately 3 billion of these. And so that's the code to make a human being is in the sequence of these letters. And again, there's in totality, the sequence is about 3 billion bases long. So what's a protein? A protein, you can think of as being like a string of pearls consisting now of 20 different building blocks, technically amino acids, and they're often also represented with one letter codes, A, C, E, W, etc. And once the string of pearls is made in the factory floor, it then folds in three dimensions, and it's the folding or shape of that protein that determines its function. And some proteins are structural, other proteins do certain types of work within the cell, such as accelerating certain chemical reactions we all need to live. So now just look at this slightly differently. So again, I've told you the DNA is like the master blueprint, and then there are regions of the DNA that we recognize as being dedicated to telling the cell how to make a specific protein. The DNA gets converted by a process called transcription into RNA. But again, for you and me, we can just think of this as being like the Xerox machine that's gonna make the copies of the master blueprint. And to let the cell know that this is a copy, the cell attaches a string of A's to the end of the blueprint. And then that goes to the factory floor to make a protein. So the technical term is protein translation, but you and I can think of this as construction. So this is the flow of information, and the sequence up here ultimately determines the order in which those amino acids are assembled. So here I'm showing you five different amino acids put together, again, like a string of pearls. Now, one last piece of jargon before I tell you what we did. So scientists sometimes refer to genes being on or genes being off, or if you will, sometimes they'll refer to genes as being expressed or not expressed. And what they mean is that you don't need all of your genes all the time in all of your cells. For example, the genes that make a brain cell aren't necessarily gonna be important in the liver. So when a cell wants to turn on a gene and make more copies and make that protein, it does so by having certain so-called transcription factors bind to that gene and the region of the gene and basically turn on that process for making the copies and hence making the protein. But at any given time, you have lots of other genes that, again, maybe they're not needed at that moment in time or in that particular cell, and they're effectively off. So why is this important in cancer? Well, cancer is caused by the accumulation of mutations in specific genes. So here I'm showing you an example where one of the 3 billion bases or building blocks is wrong. You can see this G has become a T, and that changes the instruction such that now when this protein gets made, there's a mistake. Instead of being RCL, there's a substitution. So we're not making the right protein. And literally that one change can be the difference between developing cancer or not for particular individuals. So I mentioned a moment ago, so cancer really arises when a cell accumulates mutations in specific genes, and the combination can be different for different types of cancer. So the combination for lung cancer might be different for breast cancer. And in fact, two different lung cancers might use a different combination. But the analogy I like to use is like tumblers on a lock. So cancers arise when the specific genes are mutated, putting the tumblers into position so that the lock eventually opens. Now, sometimes the first mutation is inherited from mom or dad, and those people present with hereditary forms of cancer. So that brings you to the story we worked on. So we've worked on a hereditary cancer syndrome called von Hippel-Lindau disease. And here are some kindreds who have von Hippel-Lindau disease. So the squares are the men and the circles are the women in the families. And importantly, this, the filled squares and the filled circles are people who develop cancer. And the cancers they develop include kidney cancer, blood vessel tumors called hemangioblastomas, and adrenal gland tumors called pheochromocytomas. Now, you get a sense of how devastating this is, where within, in every given generation, there's about a 50-50 chance that you're gonna have a high risk of cancer. And I will tell you that in some of these families, the disease has now been traced back to individuals who lived in the 16th or 17th century. So this is really a devastating disorder, and these people historically have lived with sort of the sword of Damocles over their neck, having seen their relatives in some cases succumb to this disease. So von Hippel-Lindau disease affects about 1 in 35,000 people. The people who developed the cancers in those kindreds I showed you a moment ago had inherited a defective version of the so-called VHL gene from either their mother or their father. And I've now told you the tumors that these patients get. Now, I highlight here in red kidney cancer because hemangioblastomas are relatively rare and pheochromocytomas are relatively rare. But kidney cancer actually turns out to be fairly common. In fact, if you look at the top 10 cancers in the United States in terms of incidence, kidney cancer is in the top 10 in both men and in women. And if you now look at non-hereditary kidney cancers, that is kidney cancers not arising in the context of VHL disease, the same gene is critical. Namely, you see that one of the tumblers, so to speak, is mutation or inactivation of the VHL gene. It's just that in the VHL families, that first mutation has already been inherited from mom or dad, whereas in the more typical non-hereditary kidney cancers, the mutation has occurred randomly sometime after conception. Now, an important clinical clue was that these tumors seen in von Hippel-Lindau disease, I mentioned the kidney cancers, the hemangioblastomas, and the pheochromocytomas, are really quite notorious for their ability to trick the body into making too many red blood, too many blood vessels. And that's because these tumors occasionally can produce a hormone called VEGF, which is like fertilizer for blood vessels. And these tumors can also sometimes trick the body into making too many red blood cells. And that's because these tumors sometimes make another hormone called erythropoietin, which is the hormone which regulates red blood cell production under normal circumstances. And what VEGF and erythropoietin have in common is that they're normally induced or activated when cells or tissues aren't getting enough oxygen. So this was really the clue to us that the VHL gene was really critical in terms of cells' ability to sense and respond to changes and oxygen, because clearly the system was broken in these tumors. These tumors were behaving like they weren't getting enough oxygen 24/7 and were putting out all the molecular distress signals that can be produced when cells aren't getting enough oxygen. Now, I introduced the idea of a transcription factor earlier. So many of these molecular distress signals, such as VEGF and erythropoietin, are under the control of a transcription factor, which scientists refer to as HIF for short, or HIF. It actually has two subunits, the alpha subunit and the beta subunit. And it had been shown earlier that the alpha subunit normally only accumulates when cells are not getting enough oxygen. And once it accumulates, it can turn on these various genes, and in particular, start producing these various proteins. So you can think of HIF as being sort of like the conductor of an orchestra, where these are different instruments in the orchestra that are going to get activated under HIF's commands. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that HIF alpha normally only accumulates when oxygen is inadequate. So in cells where the VHL protein is normal or present, you would only detect HIF alpha if oxygen levels were low. However, we showed many years ago that in cells lacking the VHL protein. Now suddenly HIF alpha can accumulate in cells whether oxygen is or is not present. And in particular, it's inappropriate for HIF alpha to be active here when oxygen is plentiful. So how does this happen? So biochemically, we showed that the VHL protein assembles with some other proteins, and their names aren't important here. But what's important is this multi-protein complex in the presence of oxygen can bind directly to the HIF alpha protein and attach a little tag that scientists refer to as a polyubiquitin chain. But all we care about is it's a little tag that then marks HIF alpha to be destroyed by a cellular garbage disposal system that we refer to as the proteasome. Whereas if oxygen levels are very low, or the VHL protein has been altered by a mutation, such as happens in kidney cancer, now HIF alpha isn't destroyed, and it can turn on those genes I referred to a moment ago, such as VEGF and erythropoietin. Now, this still begs the question, how does the VHL protein know, if you will, whether oxygen is or is not available, and hence whether it should destroy HIF alpha? And so that was the puzzle we were working on about 20 years ago, and our group and my fellow laureate, Peter Ratcliffe, came to the same answer at the same time, namely that if oxygen is present, a protein that has two funny names, either EGLM1 or PHD2, takes molecular oxygen and uses the molecular oxygen to attach a little chemical flag that scientists refer to as a hydroxyl group to the HIF alpha protein, modifying the amino acid we refer to with the letter P. And this signal had never been seen before inside the cell as a way of the cell sensing anything, frankly, let alone oxygen. So this was quite an unexpected result. And it turned out to be very satisfyingly simple, because you can see the O of the OH here actually represents an oxygen atom that has to be derived from molecular oxygen. So what was the timeline? I was asked, you know, what was the timeline? So we started working on the VHL gene in 1993. In 1995, we showed that kidney cancers that lack the VHL gene would stop forming tumors if we restored the function of the VHL gene in the laboratory. That was encouraging. By 1996, we had showed that the VHL gene was absolutely required for oxygen sensing. We also slowly identified this multi-protein complex I told you about a moment ago that's able to target other proteins for destruction. In late 1999, we knew that one of the targets was HIF. And in 2001, we discovered that oxygen-sensitive chemical flag that serves as the signal to cells that oxygen is or is not available. And then this led to the Nobel Prize in 2019. I should point out that as I was doing this work, and I should point out this was the work done by many, many talented young people in my laboratory, we did have support from the federal government, but there were several times when we were in real danger of having the work bogged down due to lack of resources. And it was during those times that the philanthropic support became absolutely critical to keep us moving forward. And we certainly, on multiple occasions, leveraged infrastructure at the Dana-Farber, including core facilities that were made possible by the generosity of people such as yourselves. And so I just wanted to say, if you didn't know you shared in the Nobel Prize, you actually did share in the Nobel Prize. And thank you for helping to make this work possible. So I've been at the Dana-Farber since 1987. I was asked what drew me to the Dana-Farber and what has kept me there. That was pretty simple. That's a pretty simple question. So here's me again in 1987, finishing my clinical training at Johns Hopkins. And I was quite sure I was going to be a practicing clinician. And at the time, and I think it's still the case today, the Dana-Farber was actually the best place in the world to train as a clinical oncologist. So I came to the Dana-Farber to become a clinical oncologist. However, as I began seeing patients, it became increasingly clear that for many of my patients, the therapies we had available were wholly inadequate. And it was clear the only path forward was to try to understand these diseases better, including at the molecular level, and to try to use that information to develop better treatments. And fortunately for me, when I was a fellow at the Dana-Farber, I had the opportunity to train with David Livingston, and it was really David Livingston who taught me how to become a scientist. But being so late to science, it was absolutely critical to me, since I was still on the steep part of the learning curve, to be at a place where the people around me were going to make me better. And throughout my career, I benefited from sort of the ecosystem at the Dana-Farber. I've had tremendous mentors, including David. I've had tremendous colleagues, including Bill Hahn, who introduced me. And perhaps most importantly, the Dana-Farber is a magnet for some of the best and brightest young people in the world who want to train to become cancer biologists or cancer physicians. And I've certainly benefited from having access to such talented people. I was asked to talk about the importance of taking risk. So especially when funding gets tight, scientists sometimes tend to become more conservative. They start doing experiments where, frankly, they're derivative. Maybe the results are virtually predictable before you even do the experiment. Maybe they're sort of Me Too experiments that we've seen done in other contexts. And there's a place for those types of experiments, but the really transformative experiments that fundamentally change the way we think about biology and medicine often entail some risk, where it's possible the experiment won't work or won't work the way you thought it would work. And that's where, again, philanthropy becomes really critical, because the federal government, again, sometimes gets conservative. And so they like to see maybe a little bit of evidence, a little bit of preliminary data that perhaps you're on the right track. And so it's often philanthropic funds that allow us to do those initial pilot experiments to generate that preliminary data that hopefully we can then parlay into federal support. So how has our work impacted patients? Well, one of the nice things about science is sometimes it pays dividends or benefits you couldn't have anticipated. So let's start now with some diseases where you might want to increase the activity of that HIP protein. I told you HIP is a master regulator of genes such as erythropoietin that stimulate red blood cell production, but HIP also regulates a number of other genes that help you survive when you're not getting enough oxygen. So in diseases like anemia or heart attack or stroke or peripheral vascular disease, we might like to have more HIP. And so just to give you an example, I mentioned the hormone erythropoietin earlier. It's the major regulator of red blood cells in mammals, including people. So during fetal life, the liver is responsible for making EPO, but shortly after birth, that job is taken over by the kidney, and the kidney becomes the major source of erythropoietin. And the problem is, if you have chronic kidney disease, you then don't make enough EPO and you become anemic. So there are about 20 million Americans who have chronic renal failure, and 2 to 4 million of these are chronically anemic. Well, now we have a way of turning HIF on if we want, because I told you that there's this little chemical flag that marks HIF for destruction. And so in principle, if we had a drug that blocked this enzyme, and an enzyme is simply a protein that accelerates a chemical reaction, if we had a drug that inhibited EGLM1, again, also called PHE2, that would block the addition of this chemical flag, and then HIF alpha could accumulate and turn on genes like EPO. And it turns out this enzyme has a very nice deep pocket into which you can find drugs, and a number of companies have now generated drugs that will bind to this pocket and turn this protein off and thereby activate HIF for the treatment of diseases like anemia. Now, one sign that these new drugs will probably be safe is, even before they were formally tested and approved, some professional athletes figured out that you could buy research grade material, or that is to say research grade versions of these chemicals, and they then began ingesting them themselves. I don't know if they were making tea or what they were doing, as a way of stimulating red blood cell production, as a way of sort of auto doping, if you will. But fortunately, these have now been formally tested. There are, again, a number of these drugs. The one I've been working with is developed by FibroGen, called Roxadustat. And again, I've declared my financial conflict of interest with Roxadustat for a variety of reasons. The first approval took place in China. So here's me in Beijing a couple years ago watching the drugs now being put in blister packs. But the drug has also been approved in Japan, and the US drug submission took place in last December. And so it's anticipated that the US approval will take place later this year. What about the other side of the coin? Are there situations where we might want to decrease HIF? Well, it turns out that many cancers, and as I told you, especially kidney cancers, they like HIF, they want HIF. But HIF also plays a role in some other diseases, such as pulmonary arterial hypertension and fatty liver disease. So what can we do about this? So I have to tell you one more thing, which is I've been referring to HIF alpha generically, but there are a couple of members of the family. I show you two members here, HIF1 alpha and HIF2 alpha. But the work we've done over the last decade or so shows that in kidney cancer, the real problem is HIF2 alpha and not the more famous HIF1 alpha, famous at least to scientists. So we really want to tackle HIF2 alpha and HIF-dependent genes. So fortunately, by the late 90s, a number of pharmaceutical companies were developing drugs against that VEGF. This is that hormone that I told you about earlier that acts as sort of a fertilizer to stimulate new blood vessels to form. And so we argued to pharmaceutical companies that if these new VEGF blockers or inhibitors were going to work anywhere, they would work well in kidney cancer, because we knew in kidney cancer they were being driven by this HIF protein as a consequence of loss of the VHL protein. So the good news is there are now a number of these VEGF inhibitors that have been approved for the treatment of kidney cancer. The first approval took place in 2004. And for some of these patients, they do well for a number of years on these drugs, but even those patients will eventually relapse. And unfortunately, there are still some patients who do not respond to these drugs. Namely, there are some kidney cancer patients who will not respond to these VEGF inhibitors. And so we have to do better. So you would argue, based on first principles, that, you know, why just take out one instrument from the orchestra? Why not take out the conductor? And why not try to inhibit HIF? And in particular, based on what I just told you, let's try to inhibit HIF2 alpha. So fortunately, some scientists at UT Southwestern identified a pocket in HIF2 alpha, and they were able to identify chemicals that bind to this pocket and can turn HIF2 alpha off. And then a little biotech company I worked with called Peloton improved these chemicals in terms of their potency and their ability to be administered to people. So these drugs look very promising. So don't be put off by this slide. These are so-called swimmer's plots. So I'm showing you data now from patients with advanced metastatic kidney cancer in a so-called phase two trial, who had failed VEGF inhibitors and failed other standard agents. And so they were really now struggling to find something, they and their doctors, that might help them. So what you're seeing here is each bar is a patient who was treated with the HIF2 alpha inhibitor and how long they remained on therapy. So for orientation, the dotted line here is a year, and the patients with the black arrows are continuing to do well on therapy. And the yellow stars are patients whose tumors actually shrank by a pre-specified amount. So at least in this very heavily pretreated patient population, there's a clear signal, and this drug has now advanced to phase three testing. Now, I started my talk talking about the von Hippel-Lindau hereditary cancer syndrome. And about 20 years ago, I found the 20-year-old version of this website, which allows VHL patients from around the world to communicate with one another about their disease, because it is a rare disease, and they often know more about their disease than, frankly, some of their doctors do. And when I first found this website, and this was in the early days of the internet, I was just so fascinated that this website existed. I said, I have to find out, where is this server? And it turned out the server was in Brookline, Massachusetts, because this was started by a woman named Joyce Graff, whose husband and son had VHL disease. Now, we were able to convince the company developing the HIF2 inhibitor, and at the time this was Peloton, but Peloton was recently acquired by Merck, to treat about 50 patients with von Hippel-Lindau disease who had never been treated with any medicine before with this HIF2 alpha inhibitor. And these patients often have multiple tumors that the doctors are just watching, trying to delay taking them back to the operating room over and over and over and over. So there was a cohort of patients with von Hippel-Lindau disease who had never been treated before, who had multiple tumors, kidney tumors, brain tumors, eye tumors that could be measured. The results aren't in the public domain yet and have not been published, but I can tell you the data look extremely promising. And if you are savvy at social media, you can actually see the Facebook pages of some of the patients on the trial where they're posting that they are responding to the treatment. And then recently a VHL patient sent me this vlog. I didn't know what a vlog was, but here's a vlog of one VHL patient who's being treated with the HIF-2 alpha inhibitor.
Hey everybody, it's Justin. I just wanted to give you a quick update. I am in a gondola right now in Taiwan. Over there is Taipei 101. The gondola is actually right by the Taipei Zoo. But I just wanted to give you a quick update and say I'm doing well. I'm enjoying my trip. If it wasn't for the PT2977 drug trial, I would have never been able to come out here and do what I'm doing right now. So I just want to thank Peloton, and I hope Merck will fast-track this drug for a VHL treatment. So if you guys are listening, hopefully you guys will put it on the market to help VHL. But keep watching these videos. I'll be making more, and I'll get better at it, and I have to get the angles right because it kind of looks fat, you know? Anyways.
I actually love that because a person that age, that's the kind of thing you should be worried about, whether you look fat in your video, not whether the doctor is going to tell me in 3 months I need another surgery, or worse yet, there's nothing that can be offered to me. Okay, so another question. What's the next big idea in cancer research? Well, this is an old slide, but it captures the idea that there's really been a sort of a tsunami in terms of our ability to isolate genes and sequence genes. So this is showing roughly the rate at which genes have been identified and sequenced, with those sequences being put in publicly available databases. And so just for orientation, the VHL gene was first isolated in 1993. So you can see my timing was good, that this was the beginning of a new era in molecular medicine. So there's an old saying, may you live in interesting times, and these are certainly interesting times. Then by the year 2001, we had our first draft of the human genome, that 3 billion base or building block sequence we referred to at the beginning of my talk. And so this gave us sort of the parts list, if you will. Finally, we could at least start to look at those 20,000 some odd genes. And then something else happened that was transformational. And that was the falling cost of doing DNA sequencing. So I'll point out this is a log scale that goes from 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, up to 100 million. The first human genome sequencing cost well over $1 billion. But then you can see over time, the cost of sequencing a human genome has fallen to the point where now it's about $1 or $2,000 to sequence a human genome. And just for orientation, some of you may be familiar with Moore's Law, which describes how quickly the cost of computing power fell over the course of time. And of course, it was this fall in computing power that led to the revolution in terms of, for example, the smartphones most of you are probably carrying with you. But there's been an even more precipitous fall in the cost of DNA sequencing. So I would say there have been three game changers in the last 20 years. So first was getting that first draft of the human genome, which I refer to as the parts list. There's been a dramatic decrease in the cost of DNA sequencing. So it's now practical to look at individual tumors and to see which genes are mutated, or put another way, to see which tumblers have been altered. And then finally, although we didn't talk about it today, there's a revolutionary technology called CRISPR, which allows scientists to go in and to manipulate the functions of specific genes in cells and in animals, so we can begin to understand what those genes normally do. Now, one place we have to get and must get is combination therapy. So you might know that there are a number of new so-called targeted cancer drugs that have been developed over the last 10 or 20 years. And these are wonderful drugs, but too often the responses to these drugs are short-lived. And in thinking about it, there's a relatively simple explanation. Suppose you had two drugs, we'll call it one drug A and one drug B. And there were rare cells within the tumor that were already resistant to, in the case of the red square, drug A, or in the case of the blue square, drug B. So if we only treated with drug A, you could be sure very quickly the tumor would be overrun by the red cells. if we only treated with drug B, the tumor would quickly be overrun by the blue cells. But the classical solution is to combine drugs that have distinct mechanisms of action, because then the probability that any one cell is going to be resistant to all of the drugs in the cocktail becomes effectively nil. And we've known this general strategy has worked for over a century. So this is what the treatment of tuberculosis looked like in the United States before the development of combination chemotherapy for tuberculosis. And likewise, you may know that being able to control AIDS depends on the use of combination antivirals. And certainly the cancers we do cure, we are almost always using combinations of effective drugs. So in closing, what I could not have anticipated in 1987 when my late wife Carolyn and I arrived in Boston was just how personal cancer was going to become to us. So Carolyn was a beloved breast cancer surgeon at the Brigham and the Dana-Farber. She diagnosed herself with breast cancer in 2003 and survived her breast cancer. But in 2010, she developed a malignant brain tumor called glioblastoma. This is the same brain tumor that took both Senators Kennedy and McCain. And being physicians, Carolyn and I both knew that the textbook answer was that she had 1 year, perhaps at most 2 years to live. We were able to put together a series of experimental therapies for her. And fortunately, she did live almost 5 years, but certainly 5 years was not enough. So I'm determined for the rest of my career to see if we can keep pushing the field forward so that if, God forbid, you know, one of our children or grandchildren gets this disease, we can do better. So I'm, you know, I've said before, as a cancer physician and a cancer scientist, it was unbearably painful when I finally realized that I had run out of bullets to treat Carolyn, and I'm not going to let that happen again to anyone else I love. So in closing, I've had a lot of time to reflect on the Nobel Prize and things that made it possible. Certainly, my timing was very good. I was born in 1957, the year of Sputnik. And so when I was a young person, there was robust bipartisan support for research, including biomedical research. And scientists and engineers were the heroes in our country, and they were respected and applauded. And, you know, young people respond to that kind of messaging. And I tell you that because I'm deeply concerned, as are some of my colleagues, that some of the messaging and actions coming out of Washington are frankly a bit anti-science and anti-expertise. And we have to correct this because, again, young people are smart and they hear these messages and they respond to these messages. And so we do this at our own peril if we don't get this right. So just as an example, some of you might wonder whether I was invited to go to the White House. In years past, presidents of both parties would routinely invite the American Nobel laureates to celebrate their achievement and to celebrate science. For reasons I can't quite fathom, the current administration does not do that. Okay, so now I think I've left hopefully some time for questions. So thank you very much for your attention.
Well, Bill, thank you so much for going over your work and for giving us your perspectives on many things. So we have a few questions. I'm going to act as the director of those questions. So I think one of them has been answered about how your work relates to kidney cancer. I think you've done a great job explaining that. One question is, and we often get this question, is how do scientists like yourselves collaborate with other scientists around the world and other cancer research organizations?
Yeah, that's a great question. And there's sometimes this fallacy that scientists don't share enough and they don't work together enough. And it's actually the opposite, especially as the science has gotten more sophisticated. It's really in your best interest to find other scientists who maybe have complementary skills who can make your work better. So I would say scientists, at least the scientists I know and admire, are constantly sort of forming different collaborations best, depending on the question they're tackling at that given moment. And then in terms of sharing what we learn, scientists, in the end of the day, don't get credit, quote unquote, for their work, unless they speak about it publicly, both in oral presentations and ultimately publish it. So actually, scientists are under tremendous pressure to share what they're discovering. And in fact, I actually worry sometimes they're under too much pressure. I want scientists to, you know, dot the I's and cross the T's before they start telling other scientists what they think they have discovered. But the bottom line is scientists do share a lot, and it's in their best interest for many reasons to share.
And there's a question about what are you currently working on in your lab?
So we're working on several things, but one of the things we're working on is to try to identify additional molecular vulnerabilities in kidney cancer so that maybe we can help develop other drugs that in time can be combined either with the HIF2 inhibitors or the VEGF inhibitors. We also didn't talk today about the fact that kidney cancers tend to be fairly sensitive to drugs that stimulate the immune system. So one of my goals before I retire, and I don't think I'm retiring soon, is I want to show that you can deconstruct completely a common cancer such as kidney cancer and arrive at a multi-drug combination that won't just control the cancer, but will actually cure it. So that's probably order of business number one. We're also trying to develop some new technologies that will help drug companies develop drugs against proteins that don't have those sort of nice pockets I referred to during my talk, and to come up with other ways that you could identify drugs that would at least indirectly turn off proteins that we know are bad actors in cancer.
Great. So I guess a related question to that is, do you think we need to find new targets or focus on known targets to come up with better drugs?
Well, I think it's a combination of both, but I certainly think we need more targets. As you know well, Bill, now that we're able to sequence cancers and look for the genes that are altered, sometimes that exercise doesn't leave us with an obvious target for the pharmaceutical companies. And so just because a protein is altered doesn't mean we can necessarily tackle it with a drug. And in some cases, the protein is missing altogether. And so it's not obvious how you tackle that with a small molecule drug. So I certainly think we need to find additional targets, but it can only help to make better drugs, in part because if we are going to build these combinations, we have to make sure that the drugs are well-behaved, that they're very specific drugs, and they don't have a lot of toxic side effects, because if they have a lot of toxic side effects, they're going to be hard to combine with other drugs.
So what capabilities would you like to see added to Dana-Farber to enhance your ability and other scientists' ability to make even more productive advances?
So I'm a little hesitant to answer that because, as you know, Bill, the breadth and depth of science at the Dana-Farber is really quite spectacular. And so different scientists, depending on their own particular interests, might give you very different answers. I will tell you that I've benefited tremendously from investments in so-called chemical biology, the old name for that being pharmacology. People who can make drug-like chemicals and study drug-like chemicals. You can't have enough people who understand protein structure. And I also benefit from having people who can study the so-called biochemistry of proteins. I guess one last area is the ability to image the activities of proteins non-invasively. So that comes under the umbrella, as you know, of molecular imaging.
Yeah, and I'll add to that, you know, from my perspective, I think one of the great strengths of Dana-Farber is that, as Bill mentioned, is that we have an amazing faculty, one that goes from the people who come to train here through people who are on the faculty. And our biggest challenge is making sure that we're continuing to bring in new blood and new ideas. And you know, the young people are the ones who are out there challenging the paradigms, and it's really an imperative for us to continue to recruit the best and the brightest, and to make the place an environment where they can do their best work.
Yeah, I would just echo that, Bill. I've said before that I figured out a long time ago that part of the secret sauce at the Dana-Farber is that the Dana-Farber attracts great young people because it's a great institution, but it is a great institution because it attracts great young people. So it works both ways. So I always say, if you want to know about the health of an institution, or especially a research institution, you know, look to see where the young people are, because they vote with their feet.
So this is a question about your views on the various forms and the sort of transformation that's happening in publishing. There are traditional outlets for publishing. There are now online sources like BioArchive, where non-peer review work is put out in the public domain. What's your view about all of this as it's gotten a lot more complicated to find information?
Yeah, that's a complicated and sophisticated question. So for those of you on the call who don't know, now there are ways scientists can put their work out almost immediately if they are so inclined, without going through so-called peer review. They can basically just post their findings to the scientific community without the traditional process that would usually entail two or three experts going through the work with a fine-tooth comb, together with the editor of a journal. And I have mixed feelings about this, because even with peer review, it's clear that some things that get published are either not completely true, or they're only true under a very, very, very narrow set of circumstances. And I fear that relates to what I said earlier, that I think some scientists feel overly pressured to get their work out quickly, and they don't always dot the I's and cross the T's the way they should. So there's a part of me that says, if that's happening even with peer review, what's going to happen without peer review, when people can just post their papers to a server? But having said that, I think there is some value to getting some things out early. And if you are a specialist in the field, you should be able to critique the paper yourself. And if nothing else, it does force you to carefully read the paper. I think there's another thing that sort of corrupted biomedical research, is that sometimes people just count how many papers someone has published and in what journals they have published, without taking the time to actually read the papers to see how well they were actually executed. So if one consequence is that people have to read the paper before deciding if it's a good paper, maybe that's a good thing.
Yeah, well, we're certainly seeing that play out right now in the news every day about the interpretation of antibiotics and certain drugs and coronavirus. I want to ask a different question, Bill. Very few people get to experience the entire experience of being awarded the Nobel Prize. I was wondering if you could tell us a couple snippets or a couple experiences that you'll never forget.
Yeah, so as you mentioned, I had been lucky enough to win the Lasker Prize and the Gairdner Prize. So the night before the announcement, I didn't think my chance of winning the Nobel Prize was zero. I thought it was pretty low, but I didn't think it was zero. And because it wasn't zero, I did go to bed with my phone on my nightstand with the ringer on. But I have to say, when the phone rang at 4:40 in the morning, you know, I felt like I was in a dream, and, you know, your heart starts racing and you look at the phone and you can see that the phone number is one that has many, many too many digits, and you quickly figure out it's Stockholm. And so you're aware that at that very moment, your life is going to change in terms of the way that you're perceived in the scientific community. I was also sort of overwhelmed with a sense of appreciation, because, as you know, Bill, there's a lot of luck involved in this business. And so I was just overwhelmed with how lucky I've been to a scientist to have had the colleagues and the trainees I've had, and to participate in this particular discovery. And I also try to point out, it's the discovery itself is really the prize. I mean, it's the thrill of the discovery. It's certainly nice when people acknowledge the work, but it's really the discovery itself. And then the week in Stockholm is just amazing. First of all, I think because they know scientists are like herding cats, the moment you land in Stockholm, you're greeted by an attaché who sticks with you like glue for the entire week to make sure you get from point A to point B. You have your own Nobel Prize mobile and a driver who gets you again from point A to point B. And everything is just so beautifully scripted to make sure everyone understands how meaningful it is, whether it's the music, the flowers, the table settings, the brush with the royal family, the dinner at the palace. It's just like being in a storybook, and you have to pinch yourself because you can't believe you're a part of this. For me, a highlight was sitting on the stage and looking out at my two children, Catherine and Tripp, who may or may not be on the call, and looking at their faces and just again feeling this overwhelming sense of gratitude and pride.
Well, thanks, Bill. I want to thank everyone for taking the time and spending it with Bill and me. We know there's a lot of things going on, and hopefully we've been able to take your mind off the world events for at least an hour. Next slide, Bill, if you could just advance that. Some people have asked us, how can I help Dana-Farber? I still want to be involved, even if the world has been turned upside down. There are many, many ways. Those of you that can, supporting our mission, particularly during this time, it continues to be important. One very practical thing, if you're local, is that we have a great need for blood and platelets, and it's safe to donate bloods and platelets. And so if you're able to and are local, we'd love that you do that. And even if you're not local, if you could find someplace close to you and donate blood and platelets, that's greatly appreciated. Engage with us online. We're, like everyone else, we're learning how to navigate a world in which you can't just go and talk to someone in the next room or invite someone to dinner. So we're doing many, many more things online. And then one, public health, just follow the guidelines and stay home and practice social distancing or physical distancing, whichever term you like better. We are going to get through this. I think one of the nice things to think about in terms of infectious disease is this will run its course, and we will eventually have a vaccine and other therapies. And this is not like cancer, in which we don't have a good answer for it. It's just going to take us time, but please have the confidence that if we do the right things, we will get through this, and this we can put this behind us, hopefully sooner rather than later. Thanks very much, and we'll be online, and hope that you'll engage with us in future presentations.
Thank you.